When somebody has gone through something themselves, it becomes like a stigma, you know, that, oh, they've gone through something themselves. How can they help somebody else? You are your own limit when it comes to wellness, you know. Like this entire lockdown, I think, was probably the toughest for me because I started feeling a lot of like social anxiety. And then I realized that I really, really need to like work on my wellness per se, of like being able to start talking to people again.
Hey, welcome back to another episode of the podcast Voices in My Head with me, Ami Radhar. Today, my guest is Rabia Chawla, who was just 14 when she started giving back to her community. She is a student of psychology, and at such a young age, being a student, she started an initiative called the Messiah Foundation, which provides a platform for young people to reach out and talk about their mental health issues. You don't want to miss this one. It's coming up now. Thank you for, you know, agreeing to do this, and I'm having
Thank you
somebody.
For having me to do this. I would honestly, I'm not the type of person to actually like sit down and do something like this with anyone. Honestly, like
so
I would never even
I'm
in my I wouldn't even think I would be able to do something.
No, but I'm glad that you've decided to, because it's funny. It's still, you know, we haven't met in person, and so many people since the pandemic started that I've been able to connect with because my book came out.
Yeah.
And similarly, I remember you had, you know, reached out, and I think you had read the book, or your friend had read the book. And then we did that Instagram live, which was great. I really enjoyed that with you. And that was my, first Instagram live, because I hate
but
social media.
But I have
media,
to tell you that like the out of the couple of Instagram lives that I did, everyone who like I meet comes back to me and says, oh yeah, we saw your live with Yamir.
Oh, how nice.
I think it stayed with everyone the most.
That's probably because of your audience, because my audience is really tiny, because I've got
I
keep going on and off Instagram.
I think we have so many common people.
Yeah, we do.
Also.
I realized that much later. Even though you're 10 years younger, but we do have a lot of people in common. And so it was nice to get to know you that way. And I just thought, because of a little bit of what I knew about your story, it would be great for you to come on the podcast and, you know, share your experiences. And I just feel that it's going to add value to someone else who's in a similar situation. And of course, we've got your foundation to talk about. So we'll get into that. So do you want to just tell me about your wellness journey if we begin with?
My wellness journey per se, I think I would say, is still something that I'm working on. Hmm. I wouldn't say I've really achieved every single thing that I want to, or that I would, you know, aspire to have achieved. And anyone, I think a wellness journey is something that is so, it continues through your life, you know, and it keeps changing as you grow, you know, as like what I was yesterday is not what I am today, literally. So I think that keeps changing, but I kind of got into, you know, like, wanting to actually take care of myself. And I think wellness is such, you are your own limit when it comes to wellness, you know, like no one can stop you from doing anything. It's only you who, you know, has to kind of put your foot down and be like, okay, this is what I need to do to like, you know, put myself first. So I think for me, the first thing I did was I started putting myself first, and like, you know, whether it was friends or family, you know, these things are, at the end of the day, you are obligated to do a certain amount, you know, but I realized that it's so important to kind of sit down and be like, okay, this is what I need to do for myself. And I actually started doing that very late, early for me, but like, I think if someone can start that a lot earlier
in life. Some people don't
do
it their whole life. Some people
exactly.
don't do it their whole life.
So I think there's no time actually that's late, you know. Anyone can start this at any point in their life. And I think no matter how old you are, whether you're like 15 right now or 50, it's important, if you haven't started, you could, like, you should. I started putting myself first and really started seeing like what my own needs were. And more than anything, I think it's just like a holistic balance of things, you know, like whether it was about eating right, my mental health per se, you know, I started realizing that it was really like not, I wasn't where I wanted to be, like in my head. And I started seeing a therapist, and it wasn't like therapy every week, you know, it was like when I felt like I needed to talk to somebody. And I think that's so good. Like, just a sounding box every now and then is so important. You know, you can use a friend as, you know, a little sounding box or whatever. But I felt like that having somebody who I don't know is so much better to just like open up to them. They don't know anything about you. They don't know like you personally. So that's what I actually started doing. And then through this lockdown, I came back from college. So I suddenly felt really like, this entire lockdown, I think, was probably the toughest for me, because I started feeling a lot of like social anxiety. And then I realized that I really, really need to like work on my wellness per se, of like being able to start talking to people again. I became so comfortable, you know, just around like my family and like the few friends that I would talk to every now and then. But like when things started opening up, I realized that like, I don't want to meet anybody.
This is funny, because I had a session with my therapist yesterday, and this is exactly what she was saying, that people have become so comfortable.
Yeah.
That it's becoming, you know, earlier switching to this pandemic mode was a problem. Now getting out of it is a problem. People don't want to meet other people. They don't want to groom themselves. They don't want to, you know, it's just become an excuse to not work, to not meet people, to.
Exactly.
And of course, I mean, I'm all for being safe, and me and my family have been extremely locked down. But this is becoming another huge mental health issue that wasn't, you know, earlier the case.
And like, it's not, I think, you know, when I never thought that I would actually have to deal with something like this. You know, you only realize that when like it's time to actually go out. In fact, it took a while for me to actually start like meeting people, or like saying yes to actually go. And then, so I think that entire thing for me was more of like of importance. And then like I ended up kind of, you know, again dealing with it through therapy and stuff. And I think that's all that I do really for my, to like take care of myself, is really just like putting myself first. Like,
can I just get you to a step back when you said, so when you were not putting yourself first, or when you said I was in my head wasn't in the place that I thought it should be. So what age was that? How did you discover that? Because it takes a lot to discover that. People go through their entire lives struggling with mental health issues and just not realizing that something's actually wrong and I need to fix
it. I think it was around like 2 years back or so, I would say. Like, I must have been around like 18 going on almost 19. And I realized
You guys are so young.
And I honestly realized that, you know what, like, I started realizing that people take me for granted and my presence for granted. Like, you know, I wouldn't say it's one particular person or a particular incident that kind of made me realize. It was just an overall like general realization that I'm just there for everyone whenever like they want. But when something is really important to you and like your close ones are not there when you need them, you kind of realize that, okay, maybe people just take you for granted because you're just always there, because, you know, like you feel like it's your duty. You feel like it's a good thing, you know. And till today, I just feel like sometimes people don't reciprocate what you want and what you do, but that doesn't make me a bad person to be the only one doing it. But I've just realized that if I would do it 110, I do it like 80 now.
Right.
You know, I know it might sound really harsh, but I've kind of realized that you'd rather not get walked all over and, you know, be miserable inside and be like, what did I do to like kind of deserve this? And, you know, you'd rather give it your 80% instead of being there 110 and, you know, putting yourself down in your own head. Because at the end of the day, like, you let it go, a person will apologize. But it kind of makes you only feel small in the end. You have to live with it, you know. And I think for me, it was a lot to do with other people. more than myself, you know, like the impact that it like other people had on me was way more important. And I think that's what I've kind of learned to outgrow of.
Right. And, you know, this is something that I struggled with too, in the sense that putting yourself first can kind of come in the area of being selfish.
Yeah.
And I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. And I mean, I tell people, please be selfish, because unless you are selfish enough to fully take care of your own needs, how can you fulfill somebody else's needs if you have not taken care of yourself? So I don't know why being selfish became a bad thing, or when did it become a bad thing?
I completely agree. Honestly, I thought about it a lot also when I was like going through my own stuff, and like, you know, kind of in my head was like, okay, this is what I need to do, this is what I want to do. And I was like, oh, like I would always keep questioning and be like, am I being too selfish? Or, and then I realized that, you know what, at the end of the day, people do what they want to do. And if you keep like thinking about how you're being selfish, you'll end up always not like not doing what you want to do, or not doing what is right for you.
And that's going to play out sometime in the future. You know, that frustration remains. My therapist said something really that stuck with me yesterday. She said that untapped potential eventually turns into a mental health issue if you don't. Yeah. So if you, let's say there is a very successful, smart woman who's just forced by her parents to get married and have kids and not pursue, or what, not let her become what she could have become.
Yeah.
That is going to end up in a mental health issue. You're going to, and they won't even know it. A lot of times, you know, it can manifest into depression, anxiety, some sort of breakdowns, anything. It can, there's so many things that, or even physical ailments. We know that the mind can cause all kinds of ailments.
Of course,
So that's something that stuck with me. And so, yeah, but coming back to this, so you started putting yourself first. How does one, how does one do that actually? Because I want to just get it from you that, was it just prioritizing yourself and your needs over someone else's, or?
More or less, I would say it was just about like, before prioritizing my own needs and what I wanted to do, I actually started like in a more holistic manner, taking care of myself. I realized that it's in, before I can even start saying no to people, I have to kind of be in that frame of mind, you know, kind of feel good from inside about myself. I just, you know, honestly, for me, like, I think we've had this conversation before, working out became like an outlet. Like, I just, it became like a outlet of all kinds of frustration for me, you know, and I kind of, I'm grateful that it was that that became an outlet for me, you know, like, not anything else. And I just kind of, for me, like, I just kind of created a routine for myself. And I was like, this is my first step to taking care of myself and prioritizing myself. I'm kind of, I made a routine, I would work out, I became like, you know, healthy, you know, just small, small, little things, you know, at the end of the day, the small things kind of add up and become more important. And then after that, I realized that, okay, fine, once I've done all this, I've made a routine for myself, where do I fit in the other things?
Right.
What are the other things do I fit in, you know? Who are the other people I should fit into my life? Who are the people I should cut out of my life? And I think starting out with just like small things, like creating a routine first, kind of balance your entire head out. And that's when you're kind of able to make a decision for yourself, what's important, what's not. Whether it was, it's not just about people for me, but even about like schoolwork, like my college work, it was, is this more important or is going out more important? You know, it's, or like, what at that point, what is more important? And I think the first thing to be able to do anything is create a routine for yourself.
And did you get that on your own, or did the therapist kind of guide you into this direction that you need to get into a routine? Because I've heard this routine, a lot of therapists help their clients to get into a, you know, a structured framework in a day. And that totally makes sense of why that helps.
So for me, I think it was more about myself. I became kind of, I started following a very, very strict routine, I would say. And now I'm trying to get out of it, because it becomes so rigid that I kind of feel like I've, a huge chunk of this social anxiety that I get is because I'm so rigid now. So
can you describe when you say social anxiety? Because I think we all have that, especially living in a city like Delhi.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I suffer from it. So what when you say social anxiety, like, what do you mean?
Honestly, it's relative, you know. Social anxiety can be different for anybody and everybody. But for me, like, I never used to be like this. I was always somebody who loved going out, meeting people, meeting my friends. Like I said, this entire lockdown kind of made me into a completely different person. But the kind of social anxiety I kind of like face is not actually, you know, the thing of going out. It's now I sit and think about, oh, like, what is this person thinking about me? You know, like, it's something, it's absolutely the most, it sounds so trivial. Like,
no, it doesn't. I don't think it does. Somebody, no, it doesn't, because I think we all feel like that. So I don't think it sounds trivial at all. I think we all have that. So please continue. Sorry, I interrupted.
So like, it's more or less just about like, oh, what is somebody else thinking about me in that time? It can be absolutely the most random person, maybe the person I met for the first time in my life. But I just think about, okay, like if I have a conversation with a person, I sit and like mull over, what did I say? Like, I hope they didn't take anything in the wrong way. Just like really small things, which, you know, it kind of, I make a mole into a mountain in my head. And that's the kind of social anxiety I face now.
Don't you think that this is all happening, including, see, our generation kind of little bit dodged it, but yours didn't have a chance, is because of social media. Because you know, not just random people, but even your neighbor with that, you know, they can recognize the area. I mean, everybody can see what you're doing and make a judgment about it. And that is what social media thrives on, is judging other people. And I'm sorry to say, I mean, I know it's the bread and butter for a lot of us. It's bread and butter for my wife. She can't run a business without social media. Yeah. The social media has made their business, essentially. So I understand the pros, but for maybe people like you and me, or people who have social anxiety or don't want to get judged or have overthink that, you know, what are they going to think? Yeah. This is why I keep going on and off Instagram, because the moment I feel it's not good for my mental health, I just leave it. So my question was that, don't you think that this has become so much more of an issue because of social media?
I think for sure. And, you know, this entire like pandemic phase or whatever, we all kind of just like depended on it for everything. And me too, like including me, it was a platform that I used for everything, you know, like whether it was keeping in touch with people, starting Messiah, you know, doing like, okay, even reaching out to you, I reached out to you through Instagram first, you know. So I think we all, those are, I think, pros in its own way, but like definitely it's something I would say it's so unhealthy. Like, I recognize how unhealthy it is for me also, but I spend most of my day like just scrolling through Instagram because there's us still, like, I feel like still I feel like I have nothing else to do. Like, when I have nothing to do, I'm just like, okay, let me scroll through Instagram.
And I think that's the worst, when you have nothing to do.
It's actually the worst. Rather than finding something productive. I have identified it and not done anything about it is just as bad.
No, but you know, it's not just you. I think it's everybody. It's everybody. And I am, I still feel like, you know, you're an adult now. You've reached that stage that you're, are you 25 yet?
No,
you're not 25. So why I think 25? Because your prefrontal cortex would have fully developed by 25, which is why they say that, which is why, frankly, the legal alcohol limit is 25. So you can, you still actually can't make those decisions, which till your prefrontal cortex is fully formed. And I'm not trying to sound very, you know, educated and intelligent about it. It's that, you know, that's just what it is. Yeah. And I've read a bit about it. But now, like, I see my, you know, other people in my family, younger kids, 12, 13, 14, even younger. I mean, that's the addiction to technology is
something
insane.
Else.
And you can imagine what you started feeling at maybe 17, 18. How does a 13-year-old girl who's already going through so many changes, hormonally, school, boys, this, that, and then this social media with unrealistic expectations of what life is.
I think it's very overwhelming.
It's a actually the pandemic is the mental health is the pandemic.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to get over COVID. There'll be some other pandemic in 10 years. There'll be some other disease. But this is only getting worse. And I don't know if we're doing enough to... I know that there's a huge conversation and awareness about mental health now, but I don't think we're doing enough to stop it. I don't think there can be done enough to stop it.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think what more can be done, you know? Like, at the end, I've realized that it has to come... See, mental health is something, or like an intervention for mental health is something that can only be given to a person once they realize they need it. Sure. You know, it's not something that you can force upon a person, or it's not something you can impose and be like, I think you need this, you know, because that's also, I think with physical ailments, I'm not comparing, don't get me wrong here. They're as important. But with physical ailments, it's something that is noticeable. You can see it, you can identify it. I think with mental health, it's something that takes so long to even kind of pinpoint at what is really wrong or what is something that you're actually facing. And that can only happen when a person realizes themselves that, okay, I really need help. I really need to pinpoint what's wrong. A lot of times people just think that, oh, and like you're saying, this pandemic is a mental health pandemic. A lot of people just use it as an excuse now that, oh, like I'm feeling like this because, you know, COVID, or I'm feeling like this because of the lockdown, I'll get over it. But there's a lot more to it. There's like I just discussed about having this kind of social anxiety of feeling like I don't want to go anywhere. It's purely just awareness that I know that this is not how I was. And that comes from being aware about yourself, you know?
Understood. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I just feel that, at least we are talking about it. There are people as young as you. So I want to also talk about, so when did you decide to study psychology and why?
I was actually 14.
Wow.
When I...
But and did that have anything to do with your own understanding of something? No, you know, there's something in my head. Absolutely. I need to understand why am I feeling like this?
Nothing. Sorry, it looks like I've got
makeup on because there's sun straight away coming like through the window here. Good weird. Guys, I promise I'm not using any filters. I don't need to. I don't give a damn on what you think I look like. I just care about what you get out of this conversation. So sorry, that was just on a lighter note.
But it had nothing to do with me or about how I was feeling or about what I want. You know, at that time, I actually... I did my first internship when I was 14 years old.
Wow.
And they really like threw me under the bus. And I honestly, at that point, I was like, why am I doing this? Because I was only 14 years old and I didn't know.
In a corporate or something to do with
this? No. I was actually working at Save the Children.
Okay. I have heard
it's that. It's an NGO, like a worldwide NGO. So you could say it's like a multinational NGO, so they decided to put me into like field work, and I used to go like into some like really, really like far out village every day and just like deal with children who were, you know, some were even my age. So I think it kind of really took a toll on me to kind of get comfortable with it for the first couple of weeks. And I used to kind of help the teachers and the, you know, the staff over there to get children who are dealing with addiction, and like some were addicts, some were like, you know, on strange kind of like drugs and stuff, kind of getting them, not really getting them out of it, but getting them back into mainstream schooling because they had dropped out for these reasons.
Right.
It was not very related to what I want to do now, but that kind of made me realize that, okay, like, this is what I want to do. Like, this is where I want to go into. Maybe not help, like, maybe not into, like, the education part of it, but more into, like, understanding what made those kids get into becoming addicts.
Okay, that's fascinating.
You know, relying on substance or whatever. And what are they dealing with that they need to, you know? And a lot of times we would, like, I would just sit and, like, talk to maybe a child or whatever and be like, what is like going on at home? And it all boiled down to like their home environment that kind of got them into doing it. And that's when I realized that, you know, there's so much that goes on in your head, and you might be 10 years old and you're an addict, which was really shocking for me because I was only 14. I had not been exposed to any of this. But I think at that point, I might have found it really hard. I would come home, I would cry because it was so difficult. But by the end of it, I realized that it was the best thing I could have done. And that's when I realized that this is what I want to do and I want to go into psychology. And I didn't know at that time what I wanted to really do in psychology. Till my, like, in my first year of college, I was focusing more on sports and exercise psychology. And then I was like, okay, no, this is not what I want to do. So I really like went through different phases and I was like, okay, now I want to do this. I want to do this.
But so what have you finally zeroed in on?
So now I finally decided to go into counseling and therapy for children.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah. More, I mean, not very into like the developmental part of it, which again, I experienced for a couple of months. And then I was like, okay, it was a great experience. But this is not what I'm cut out to do. It was, again, very emotionally taxing for me because I got really attached to those little 2.5-year-old kids
who,
you know, going through whatever. It's also very difficult to see a child who's having a developmental issue when they're 2.5 because they can't talk.
Yeah.
They can't express themselves. And I think that was another very, very good learning experience for me, that how to be patient.
I think that's amazing. You did that at 14. You're, you know, with people your age now, younger and younger, are doing such amazing things. I was probably wasting my time even till I was 30. I told you that before. So I think it's amazing that you guys are doing all this. And now, so just out of interest, this degree, you're going to be certified to be a counselor, or how does it work?
So as of now, I mean, it's only my undergrad. So after this, I'm applying for a master's.
Three-year undergrad in UK.
Yeah, three-year undergrad. And now 2 more years, I'm applying for a master's in counseling. And then I'll get a license to work as a therapist.
Can you still work? Can you work in India, or that license won't
be? Yeah. No, I can work in India. Which,
okay, that would be fantastic. Yeah, we'll send many clients your way. Please let me know.
I will need that if I become a therapist.
So I'm sure you will. I have no doubt that you will. And I think somebody with your kind of calling and that experience of your own mental health, I think those people, you know, become the best therapists.
I actually wanted to talk about this as well, that, you know, I have seen a lot of people also that when somebody has gone through something themselves, it becomes like a stigma, you know, that, oh, they've gone through something themselves, how can they help somebody else? But I think it's those people who have overcome something it's so much more, your interaction with another person is so much more effective and fruitful because you've gone through it yourself. You can actually put yourself in another person's shoes and be like, you know, I have juggled through a lot of therapists and found so many non-effective for me.
Exactly,
it's,
yeah.
Sometimes it's hard to actually find somebody who you can actually connect with. But it's those people who, the one who I actually still continue to like seek help from is somebody who, she's gone through stuff herself and she can actually put herself in my shoes and say, okay, like, I know what you're going through at this point of time, you know, I've been through it. And I never shirked away from it that she went through something herself, because I realized that if she's gone through it, she knows every bit of the highs and lows of it.
Absolutely.
You know? And that's something I think people really need to overcome, that if they've gone through, and I've heard this multiple times, if she's gone through it, she could have helped herself. Oh God.
No,
like,
no, that's the stupidest thing. If somebody told me that, I guess you also, we need to realize that dumb people in the world, the dumb people will continue. Yeah. I wish I could do something to fix that, but that neither of us can.
Yeah, no, I
sensitive statement.
You know, this is something that I learned in school when I was 16 years old, and my principal said that common sense is something that no one has.
Yeah.
You know,
sure.
And it stuck with me for so many years. I was like, it's so true, because we all say, oh, it's common sense, but none of us have it. None of us have common sense, you know, as much as we would like when you just use it so like loosely and you say it's common sense or it's obvious. I feel like nothing is obvious. You have to learn about everything. You have to be exposed to it to know about it.
And especially about mental health, unless I think, and I don't wish that upon anyone, but I think to truly empathize with someone who's had a mental health issue, you have to have had a mental health issue yourself. You can't feel that. I mean, if I say that I know what the soldiers feel like if they get shot in their arm. I too have no bloody idea till I get shot in my arm with a bullet.
Which hopefully you should not.
No, no, I'm just like giving a example till I get shot. I have no idea what it feels like.
Yeah, of course.
You can imagine, you can do all that. But what I can only hope for is that people, and I think I know that's slowly happening, that are educating themselves. There's so much conversation about mental health, that people are at least becoming a little bit empathetic or sensitive, that at least don't say this, even if you want to say it in your mind and judge the person.
You know, even like my mom sometimes says things to me and I'm like, think twice, like, you know, you're saying it to me, it's okay, don't say it to anybody else. You don't realize in the spur of the moment what you say. It could be something really small, like not directed towards anybody, like just a very general statement, but somebody else can take it really badly. You know, you just have to be like a little mindful about what you say, because people are very sensitive to words, you know, and we don't realize.
That's how we communicate, right? So
yeah,
words are important.
Exactly. And I think, touch wood, people are becoming more aware of to choose their words wisely.
I think the process is slow, but at least there is a huge discussion over it, right? There it's happening, it's moving in that direction. So let's talk about Messiah Foundation. So how did you start it? What is it about? How does it link with what is focusing on coming out of your own maybe past insecurities or your past issues? So if you could just share that with us.
So I actually started Messiah because I...
Firstly, where did you get the name from? I love asking people, how did you come up with the name? Why Messiah?
So why Messiah? Honestly, it was something that I was just like thinking about, and I was like, what does it mean? Like, I had seen it somewhere and then I was like, I really like it. You know, like I really like the name. I went through the meaning and everything and it just worked out. It basically means holistic happiness.
Right.
And I think that really stuck with me. And I was like, this is what I just believe in, that, you know, one should just be overall happy, you know, and happiness is again, something very relative. Like I'm happy and, you know, it could mean something absolutely different for you.
Sure.
You know, and, but the entire thing behind it was just, I felt a very like positive kind of, and I even thought about the colors that I used of my logo and everything. Cause I was like, yellow is a very happy color. Honestly, so in psychology, you really go into like the psychology of colors as well. And you know, like,
what is this color saying about?
Just means you're a very vivacious person.
Oh, I don't think my wife will not agree with you, but okay, I'll leave it at that.
No, but there's a lot of psychology behind colors and how people perceive things as well. So I really thought into all of that as well, but for me, Messiah honestly just came out of purely out of what it meant and what I felt when I heard it, you know.
Right.
Felt like it's easy, it's something people would be able to say, people would. That was the whole like different aspect behind it.
And but, now the what is it?
Yeah. Started it actually because why I started it, it's basically a foundation which kind of, you know, helps people. We let people reach out to us. We're like the middleman between, let's say, any person and a therapist. And we also have like a bunch of, you know, like peer supporters and like people who we have on our team who kind of are we basically provide emotional support to people who are dealing with self-esteem issues, anxiety, body image issues. And
this is for free, obviously.
It's all free. And we kind of are that bridge. I tried to create a bridge between people and like professional therapy.
Fantastic. It was required.
A lot of people sometimes feel hesitant, you know. I've had a lot of people come up and be like, oh, we don't know how to reach out to people because our parents are not okay with it.
I was going to bring that up, that it's a taboo in the homes and this doesn't sound like you're going to
So for that, that was the whole purpose behind it, that, oh, like you just have a friend you're talking to, you know? And sometimes a lot of people don't need that, like that therapy. They just need a sounding box. Like I said before, you know, it could just be a friend. And I tried to create that anonymity behind it and have that that third person kind of thing that you have with a therapist, the person doesn't know who you are. Like, there are a lot of times I know personally, I know people who have reached out and been like, okay, we want help, but I have stepped back and been like, okay, I'll, you know, tell somebody else, because I will have a personal bias towards you. I will know so, I know so much about you, you know, and that may actually stop you from talking to me because you know me so well. So just trying, I just try to create that kind of bridge between a therapist and a person, and touch wood, it's been going well. I've had a lot of people reach out and actually not even reach that phase where they needed therapy as such, and they felt better just talking.
That's fantastic. You fixed, you know, you're already providing a solution.
So I think that's what it was all about. And,
this is all online, I assume, obviously, because pandemic,
Yeah, exactly. As of now.
Do you ever plan to take this offline in terms of have a physical center as well?
I mean, I hope to. I would want to take this on eventually once I finish studying as well. I don't want to stop doing this, because I feel like it was needed. And I thought it was needed because at that time, before I started it, I was going through my own like body image issues and self-esteem issues. And I didn't have a sounding box, you know.
Of course.
I didn't have that emotional support. I definitely had my friends. My friends and family were really supportive. They were all really open to like listening to me and hearing me out. But I also started feeling that, you know, a therapist is not your friend, let me tell you. And I'm you probably know that.
They're supposed to be your friend.
They're not meant to be your friends, you know. You have that 1 hour time slot, that's it, you know. But what if at some point I just need to like vent to somebody, you know? And I think that is also something that you have to be aware of, that your friends and family are not there at your beck and call, you know. They're not gonna hear you out whenever you want. And a lot of times, like, I don't want to be like, I'm just being very like open. You don't want to come across as somebody who's constantly like shitting on another person, you know, just like taking their stuff out. And that's why I felt like I don't have that kind of that sounding box that is somebody I don't know, but is not my therapist, you know, at the end of the day. And I felt like I wanted to create that for the people who maybe are going through the same thing and feel like they just need a friend. And you know, I told you this before as well, that there are days where there are weeks where I have nobody reach out, you know, but then there are times where even if it's three people or even one person in like 2 weeks, least somebody knows that this exists for them. This is there for them. And even if it's one person that, you know, we're able to help out, it makes a huge difference, not just to me, but I feel like to them. And that's what makes me happy, because I've been able to provide them with that platform that they don't have to go through. For me, it was basically about, I don't want anybody else to go through what I went through.
Yeah, of course. Same reason for, I think, all of us. Same reason for me, I'm doing this. Same reason I wrote my book will hopefully keep writing. Is that I just don't want anybody to go through what I've gone through.
And you learn from others' experiences, you know. And this is why, again, like, I'm very open to doing stuff like this, because it's, you hear another person out and sometimes you feel like, okay, maybe I'm going through the same thing and I'm not alone. I'm in the beginning, obviously I was a little scared when I started Messiah and I started doing these lives and like, you know, I did one like webinar with like this mental health organization in between. And I was like, do I really want to do this? And I realized that it's better to just be open about what you feel and what you've gone through, because it makes it normal for another person to talk about it. You know, they don't think twice before saying, okay, I'm feeling something.
I mean, and if somebody who's watching, listening to this episode of the podcast, if they want to help, I mean, do you also take in volunteers who can...
Oh yeah, we do, definitely. Help,
who can become part of Messiah, because I know that maybe people would be interested in that, or if someone
we're
can...
always open.
How can somebody contribute?
We're always open to, you know, getting more volunteers. In fact, the more, the better, you know, because right now we're just like small group. A lot of people were students, and, you know, once schools and colleges opened up, it kind of, a lot of people were psychology students.
Right.
And that was a big prerequisite for me with students, because I was like, or people who've actually, you know, overcome something, because for me, I really wanted to go through that and be like, okay, these are the people I feel will be sensitive. I would not just take anybody on as a volunteer. It's a very sensitive thing to kind of,
of course, there's confidentiality. There are many things that come
exactly.
into
there's play. A lot of, even just the way that you deal with another person, the way you talk to another person. I think when you are when you've been through something yourself, you realize that you have to be sensitive towards another person, choose the right words. You know, those things can be big trigger points for another person. And just the fact that, you know, there were a lot of students who were psychology majors, and I felt that, okay, fine, at least these people know what they, you know, what it's all about. But we're always open to volunteers. Like, you can drop me an email or whatever on the Messiah email, which is there on.
Yeah, I'll share it on the, when I do the editing, I'll share it in.
And it's a very simple process. Like, just drop me an email. There's a form to fill and a couple of questions. That's it.
And what if I'm seeking help? So I just go on the Instagram or the email.
Anything,
or the
Instagram, the email.
There's a website also.
There's a website. There's a, we have like on Instagram itself, we have like a way to contact us on WhatsApp.
Okay.
So it's a very easy process. It's all
and,
there.
And just out of interest, what is the kind of ratio of men is to women or girls is to boys reaching out to you? Just out of interest. And I hope it's a healthy ratio.
I can't put a number to it, but I would say,
broadly speaking,
definitely a lot more girls.
Okay.
Than
you think that's because, well, I have several theories on that. One is, of course, I keep talking about it. You know, it's not macho to be.
Yeah, I think a lot of it has sensitive. To do with that. I have a lot of men who do reach out first thing that we have anxiety. Mm. And then when you start talking to them, you realize that it's stemming just from a self-esteem body image aspect. Sometimes, a lot of times. And they just don't want to kind of, you know, admit that they have this, you know. I'm glad that even if it's, I'm just giving a rough ad hoc number, even if it's five guys as opposed to like 10 girls.
I don't see, you know, where this came into our psyche. I think it's probably popular culture or movies or all this stuff where men are not allowed to cry or boys don't cry. Like, you know, if my son, I never let anybody tell my son if he's crying that, oh, be brave, oh, ladkiyon ki tarah mat bano. I was like, listen, please cut out this crap.
Yeah.
If he is crying, I said, listen, I know it's, or whatever, let's say he's got hurt. Okay, I know it's hurting. I know it's okay to cry.
Yeah.
Firstly, it needs to be okay to bloody cry. It doesn't matter if you're a man,
just
woman, dog, cat,
emotions,
snake. Like, just go for it. And I think that is so important, especially for young parents like myself. Like, if your kids are crying, please don't find, just because, of course, nobody wants their child to cry, right? Nobody wants
naturally.
Their child to cry, or nobody wants whoever. So don't try and do this thing. This is when this kind of stuff sets into your subconscious so deep that boys don't cry or be macho.
I was just
going to
say it starts
okay
at a young age, you know.
Seek help.
It all starts, it all starts at a young age. And when you, like, I don't know if this is the right word to use, but when it's fed into your mind at such a young age, it's such an impressionable age, your mind is still like molding into, like, you know, you're growing. It sticks, you know, at the end of the day. And sometimes when you're old enough, it's very hard to kind of mold that out of your mind. It's kind of entrenched in you. It's part of your personality eventually, you know. So it's...
And the second issue just came to me is that, so firstly, you're embedding that boys are supposed to be strong and girls are supposed to be weak. So you're also setting this precedent for, in my mind, for kind of girls are kind of inferior to you or they're weaker than you.
Exactly.
And that's not the case. And these are the same, and of course, an extreme example, these are the same men that go on to ill-treating their wives and girlfriends and beating them up and doing all that. So please raise sensitive boys, guys.
Yeah.
It's not sissy to cry, or it's not sissy. It's okay. Just like get with it.
Yeah.
Like, educate yourself or allow us to educate you a little bit if we can.
Yeah.
Because, you know, this is like, I get irritated when I hear stuff like this, and there's no need for that. You can there's in there enough opportunities for boys to be macho, but when you're having an emotional issue or a mental issue, that's not the time to be macho about it.
You can't,
you know, you can push through pain at a set in a gym or in a sporting or in some sort of event where you're supposed to use your endurance or stamina or strength, but your mind is not that place to mess around.
Definitely with. Not. And I think even like when you're, these things also kind of eventually, there's so many like studies that are done, and this is purely because I'm studying it right now, so it's very fresh in my mind, so I'm talking about it.
But please share.
There's so many studies that are also done about how, you know, whatever mental health issue a person may have, maybe depression, anxiety, it all, when you go through analysis and you do kind of studies on a particular patient and you go through like what kind of intervention and therapy they should use, a lot of times it kind of boils down to an experience that they've had in their childhood, you
100%,
know?
100%, yeah.
And I think we all have had some experiences in our childhood that kind of stick with us and come out, you know, the frustration comes out in different ways, and sometimes it develops into actual mental health issues. So like you said, it's just kind of important to be sensitive in how you're like what you're teaching your children at a young age.
Yeah, you know? And I know it's impossible to be the perfect parent. There's no such thing, but at least broadly the things we know, that don't say certain things, don't behave certain way, help them to grow as sensitive adults rather than see, because it's impossible to prevent later on a mental illness or something like that from, but you can at least give a good foundation.
For sure. I agree.
To try and build the best future adult or the best future person. It's a difficult job. Parenting is it's never been easy. I know it wasn't easy for our parents. And it's much, much, much harder now because today's parents are up against digital, social media, these mad consumption economy brands, ultra mad competition.
Yeah.
You know, he came to school with this big shoe. So I need shoes which are like, you know, this is, it's almost become comical. And I mean, I see that with my son's too young. He's just starting school.
Yeah.
He'll be going to your school. I told you that. Or he's already going to your school online. Alyssa, I've really enjoyed our conversation. Would you like to talk about something else?
The only thing that I would actually want to say, like before, like we end this and all, is just that I would like to tell everybody whoever's listening to this that just like start prioritizing yourself. It's very important in the long run. And you know, you also say that I'm really young and all that, but I feel like the earlier you start, the better it is for you. And I think you can also vouch for that, you know, the earlier you start, the earlier you realize that it's important to kind of put yourself first. And by put yourself first, I mean, like, look into your own needs. Sometimes just unwind. It's a great feeling. So I would literally just tell everybody to just like switch off. And just because I scroll through Instagram all the time, it's not something I would advise everybody
We all scroll through Instagram.
It's not something I would advise everybody to do. And just be open, you know, if you're feeling something, talk about it. Don't keep it inside. It only manifests into something worse. And from somebody who has gone through their own issues, mental health issues, body image issues, felt a sense of major like self-esteem issues, now social anxiety, which is better, and all of that combined together, I would just literally say that talking about it helps so much. And whether it's Yamir or me or Messiah, just reach out to anybody who you are comfortable talking to. It really, really helps.
No, I was going to say the same thing, that anybody who's listening, please reach out. Rabia has built this fantastic platform that you're hearing this. There are tons of ways to get in touch with Messiah Foundation. I'll put them up on the screen. And this is a great way, especially for those, if you feel that there is some taboo in your household or you yourself just don't want to put that, I guess, burden, if I can use that word, on your mind that I'm seeing a therapist or a shrink. So before you take that step, reach out to Messiah Foundation, and they'll, you'll have someone to talk to and someone to take you through and make you feel better. And so thank you, Rabia. This was delightful, and I'm glad we did this now. We should have done this a long time ago.
Yeah.
I'm so grateful to Rabia that she could share her own issues and her own past with us so candidly. And I'm also grateful again for the foundation that she set up. I really love the idea of having a place to go to before you need to go to a counselor or a psychologist or a therapist, where someone can talk to you like a friend. And Messiah Foundation is doing that. They're doing great work, and I'm so happy to be associated with Rabia in any little way that I have been through this podcast. I hope you all enjoyed listening and got something meaningful out of it. I know I did. Your feedback means a lot, and if you want to support the podcast, please like it, please comment, please get in touch with me through all the social media mediums that we have available, and feel free to get in touch with Rabia and Messiah Foundation. The details are given below. See you soon on the next episode of Voices in My Head. Till then, take care.
Voices in My Head is created and hosted by Yami Radhar. This podcast is for information purposes only. Statements and views expressed on this podcast are not medical advice. We disclaim responsibility for any adverse effects that may arise from any information contained herein. Opinions of guests are their own, and this podcast does not endorse or accept responsibility for statements made by guests. This podcast does not make any representations or warranties about guests' qualifications or credibility. If you think you have a medical problem, consult a licensed physician.